Greetings, dear brothers and sisters. Welcome to yet another day when we share the good news, the word of God, and this university campus ministries. Let us begin with a word of prayer, my dear friends. Let us pray. Mighty Father, mighty God who dwells up in heaven above, Lord, we are back again at your holy feet. We are just sinners, mighty Father, who desire to be transformed so that you can seal us in our foreheads with the seal of the living God. Lord, cover us with your righteousness as we bow and humble ourselves at your holy feet, mighty God. Wash our sins with your precious blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary. Give us wisdom so that, Lord, we can draw closer to thee. So by the time you close the books of judgment, we will be perfectly united with thee and reflect your likeness, Almighty Jesus, so that we can receive the seal of the living God. Today, as we are going to study, we pray, Lord, that you use me just as a humble instrument. The listeners and the students who are here, we pray that you bless each one of us, Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, my dear brothers and sisters, today we are going to tackle a very, very important topic. Very, very important topic. Actually, today we are going to look at the battle of Armageddon. That's a very, very serious topic. And the seven last what?
Plagues.
Exactly. The seven last plagues. So this title is very, very sensitive because we are going to look at the Battle of Armageddon. But first of all, let's go to the Bible. Let us read from the Bible, our opening text of today. Let us read from the book of Revelation. We love that book, don't we? So today we're going to read in Revelation chapter 14, verse 9, the third angel's message, we know it. Revelation 14, verse 9, let's remind ourselves, and 10, because it's so much attached to the lesson today. Revelation 14, verse 9 says, I'll read here quickly. And the third angel followed them, following the two other angels, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. This is serious, my dear brothers and sisters. This is very, very serious. So there's something that I want to explain about just this verse before we dive into today's lesson. You know, the mark of the beast, the mark of the beast, the 666, being received in your forehead. In your forehead, my brother. So it's talking about not on your forehead, but in your forehead. That is what the Bible says there. There's a reason why the Bible, the King James Version, the original Bible, the Bible we should all be trusting, there's only one true Bible. In your forehead is not on your forehead. So some people say there will be a 666 that will be written on our foreheads. That is not the way it goes. It is inside the head, because the reception of the mark of the beast is to accept the National Sunday Law that will be passed inside your brain. And then on your hand is to accept to work, because we're going to be forced, my dear brothers and sisters, to be working on the holy day of the Lord, on the Sabbath day. Later on today, we'll discover why it is very important. And out of all the Ten Commandments, the fourth commandment is the most important commandment, because it is the seal. It's the commandment that has the seal of the living God. Even in early writings, Spirit of Prophecy, the prophet saw the two tablets of stone, and one particular commandment was shining more than all the other nine, and that is the Sabbath commandment. Because this is the commandment that will end this world. This is the commandment which we say will end this world. But before we go any further, my dear brothers and sisters, let us look at the current affairs, what is happening as we are drawing closer to the passing of the National Sunday Law. What is the devil, the enemy doing? This is DW here, DW News. This was, I think, yesterday. The headline there is saying New World Order. BRICS nations offer alternative to West. You know, the BRICS nations, we have which countries, my brother? Brazil, economics. Now we go back to economics. You are students here. We go back to economics school. Some of us have been teaching economics for 17 years. Economics, BRICS. We have trading blocks in economics, okay? These are the ones that rule the world. We have here where we are, we have COMESA, okay? We also have SADC. Zambia is a member of SADC. It's a trading block. It's also a member of COMESA. We have ECOWAS, okay? Some countries in East and West Africa there. We also have the European Union, which is the biggest trading block. Yes, now there is BRICS, which is making noise. Now, BRICS did not start today. It's just that because I know most of you here, you're not economic students. But BRICS has been there for some time. Basically, these are countries, Brazil, Russia. We have the I is for India. The C is for, which country is C, sir? Don't tell me it's Cameroon. China. China is part of BRICS and it's a major country. And then we have the last one, which is South Africa. In fact, South Africa joined later on, a few years after they formed BRICS. So BRICS is a serious trading bloc because Russia and China are in that trading bloc. And these now are going to be enemies. Already they are enemies of the United States. We know China is already, is it yesterday they were doing military drills? Yes. In Taiwan? Taiwan is a base where they will fight America. Just like America is fighting using the base called what? Ukraine. To fight Russia. So basically, we will have chaos in this world. Now, in economics, when I read to you what's written here, you understand that it's not, I'll explain to say it's not actually an advantage when these people say we can do without America, we can do without European Union, we can do without the G8, the G7 countries of this world. It's really, really going to affect us. Because already the IMF is affected. The World Bank is affected because of BRICS, where Russia and India and China are a member in South Africa. Let me just read here a little bit here. Okay, here you can see in this newsletter, the predictions about the BRICS countries as the fastest growing economies haven't quite panned out. Instead, the alliance is now offering a diplomatic forum and development financing outside of the Western mainstream. So they want to have their own financing without the Western countries, including America. Let's continue. The founding myth, okay, of the emerging economies has faded, confirmed Gartha Mayhold, the deputy director of the German Institute for International and Security Affairs, or SWP. The BRICS countries are experiencing their geopolitical moment. Okay? The BRICS are trying to position themselves, as we read down there, as representatives of the global south, providing an alternative model to the G7. Now, the G7 are the very, very important great seven countries of this world. We know these countries compose Germany, France, UK, Italy, Japan, Canada, and the USA. These are members of the greatest seven countries of this earth. They have a group of themselves. Now, these are being challenged, and also the European Union. Now, there's this guy called Jim O'Neill. In 2001, that is like 21 years ago, when he was the chief economist of the multinational investment bank, Goldman Sachs, we know Goldman Sachs, he's the one who coined the BRICS. Okay, he brought about the BRICS and said this trading bloc is called BRICS. Now, he was challenging the World Bank model. In 2014, the challenge towards the World Bank was that BRICS had an investment of $50 billion as seed money. Now, BRICS nations launched the New Development Bank. You can even see the New Development Bank there as an alternative to the World Bank and the IMF. This has greatly affected the IMF's structural adjustment programs and the austerity measures. So when you go down on this same page, Maranatha, you'll find a lot of videos where I used to talk economics. Okay? So I used to talk about the austerity measures of the IMF. Those are the measures where IMF comes to bail out countries, to help countries who need funding. Now, this has been affected, my dear brothers and sisters, by the BRICS, this group called BRICS. Okay, let's continue there. So the structural adjustment programs, which will really, really help in Zambia, like I was explaining down there, we're no longer economists, here we are looking at prophecy. These have been affected by BRICS. Now, you can even see down there, this was last week, South Africa is being used by a joint military drills and exercises which are being held by China and Russia. So China and Russia have come in to bring in joint military drills. These were just happening last week. They were having joint military what? Drills. That's the problem with your university. The other university is in a bushy arrangement. Now yours is the middle of town. And there's all those things. But anyway, we as loud cry blowers will be moving from the bush to coming to town. So we need to get used to these things. We'll not be blowing it in the bush. No. We'll be coming here to blow the loud cry, during the loud cry. All right. Amen, sir. Yes. Now, let us begin. Today we're looking at, what are we looking at?
Battle of Armageddon.
The Battle of Armageddon, sir. We're also looking at the seven last what?
Plagues.
Plagues, yes. So, the Battle of Armageddon. So, we'll start with the seven last plagues, and then we'll finish up with the Battle of Armageddon. People just talk Battle of Armageddon. They don't even understand what this thing is about. But first of all, we'll have a lot of citations today. So, be studious, pious, and?
Intelligent.
Intelligent. Thank you, sir. All right. So, let's quote here from to start with. Four mighty angels hold back the powers of this earth till the servants of God are sealed in their foreheads. In their foreheads. Brother Nathan, before we go into our today's lesson, we are talking about the National Sunday Law. We are saying that plus or minus 2025, we are likely to have this law. We are going to have this law. Highly, highly likely to have it. Because the Laudato Si Action Plan talks so. Now, what will bring the Sunday law? Remember, if you go down, I've been talking about, in fact, is it this university or the other university where I talked about the economic meltdown? Where I talked about the predictions of economists like, is it Ray Dalio?
Yes.
Is it this university? It should be the other one. Anyway, I'm now mixed up because I meet hundreds of people every day, every week. So, what is going to bring the National Sunday Law is an economic meltdown. So when we talk about BRICS, saying let's separate from the global economic market trading bloc, the global trading bloc, this is not an advantage, my dear brothers and sisters. This is a serious disadvantage. This is what will bring economic meltdown. This is what will bring economic meltdown. And this is going to happen this year. Remember, Ray Dalio predicted that it's going to happen this year? Yeah? So this year, we'll have... It's not really a matter of having a third world war where there will be nuclear bombs everywhere and then the National Sunday Law. It is not like that. In fact, let me emphasize this point. We should have a difference between the third world war. It's coming. I've been saying it's coming. Okay? And the Battle of Armageddon. There's a difference. This is not the same thing. Oh, I can see people now getting eager. The Third World War and the Battle of Armageddon. Yes, we will have quotations today which say that when the four angels are loosened, then there will be serious ammunition, this and that. That is the spirit of prophecy. The Third World War will not wait, my dear brothers and sisters. for the four angels to be loosened. Because the four angels will be loosened when the sealing is what? Done. When the sealing of the 144,000 is what? Is done. So the third world war will not wait until then. The third world war will come before then. But the third world war is basically not the weapon the devil might use to bring economic meltdown. We're already seeing how economic meltdown is coming. It's trading blocks separating. They are using many mechanisms. Economic meltdown, remember in 2008, some of you students of economics, some of you watching me there have taught you economics, you're working in various places, banks and so on. The 2008 economic meltdown came because of what? The credit crunch, which was in the American banking system. That was enough. Now, to this time, Corona can be a reason to bring it down. Remember how Corona brought it down?
Yes.
Yes. This time, these trading blocks which are dividing, it can bring it down with the rumors of wars that are there. So it might not necessarily be nuclear bombs, because three nuclear bombs of Putin can destroy Africa in 10 minutes. So it might not necessarily be that. It will be just the devil bringing a program of economic distress. When that happens, there will be a revolution. Revolutions, not only in Zambia, everywhere. Exactly what the prophet said in the book Great Controversy. The revolutions that happened in France, remember? In the year 1798, between 1797, somewhere there, up to 1799. There were revolutions. That's the period of Napoleon Bonaparte.
Yes.
Uh-huh. What did he do?
He conquered,
captured the Antichrist, the Pope.
Yes.
Sent him into the desert, into exile.
Yes.
And he died there.
Yes.
That is the time, now it's easy to remember the day. That is the time when there was the French Revolution. In fact, some people were telling me that what has happened, we're not seeing the series of Great Controversy anymore. We're not seeing the series of, what other series are we doing there? We were just doing Judgment, Order and Events. Yeah, yeah. It's because God assigns us what to do, my brothers and sisters. We haven't quit those series. They are coming. They are coming. Great Controversy is coming. Judgment, Order and Events is coming. We'll even have another one after that. I think we're left with two episodes to finish Judgment, Order and Events. I'm just busy. I'm now doing door-to-door evangelism. God gave me a target. Every day, at least 10 to 20 people. So in a week, the target is almost 100. Towards 100. So it's something which is really spiritual uplifting me. But immediately, he tells me to come back to that. We are going to resume. So do not worry. There are some of you who are complaining that the Great Controversy series is on a slowdown. But basically, economic meltdown brings the French Revolution. Now it will be a global revolution already. Those of you who are watching news, you are able to see that in Israel, there has been some revolutions. Look at these characters. Look at these characters. Look at who's this one in South Africa, the opposition leader.
Julius Malema.
Look at him. This is a revolutionist. This is a communist. Look at us in Zambia here. Who is this one? Fred Membe.
Yes.
Fred Membe. People are saying Zambia doesn't have an opposition because of UPND. There is no government which will not have an opposition. So PF, forget, they are gone. But they will join hands with Freddie Membe, who will be leading this. They are all communists. They are all coming here to be. They are saying they are freedom fighters. Eh? The Mandela. They are revolutionists, like the South Africa, Julius Malema. Here we have Freddie Membe. In Uganda, there is Bobi Wine. And all these characters are wearing red. All these characters are wearing red. So these people are going to come and they'll bring revolutions. So these revolutionists will bring strikes and riots. It's because of the economic meltdown. Already, people even here in Zambia are saying, yeah, HH, there's no money in the streets. You've heard such stories?
Yes.
Yeah, and they approach me as if I'm still in politics. I say, no, I don't know these things. I'm no longer in politics. But you used to defend HH. I said, no, please, now I'm no longer under HH. I'm under Jesus Christ. So if you tell me about Jesus Christ and how I should defend him, I'm going to do that. So everywhere in the world, people are complaining and this is not going to improve. And then these now opposition guys will come up and they'll have revolutions. And these revolutions will bring now chaos. These people are dangerous. Julia Malema's, Bobi Wine's, and the hunger that will strike these nations. People will rise. There is no president going to stop them because his prophecy just has to be fulfilled. They will rise like the French Revolution. When you look at the reasons why the French had the revolution, it was hunger. One of them, there were like five reasons. There was hunger, political strife, even religious views. So the same is going to repeat itself, says Spirit of Prophecy. My dear brothers and sisters, let's go today for our quotation. Let's quote here. Four mighty angels hold back the powers of this earth till the servants of God are sealed in their foreheads. In their foreheads, the nations of the world are eager for conflict, but they are held in check by the angels. When this refreshing power is removed, there will come a time of trouble and anguish. Deadly instruments of warfare will be invented. Vessels with their living cargo will be entombed in the great deep, the oceans. You know, those submarines and all those things. All who have not the spirit of truth will unite under the leadership of the satanic agencies, but they are to be kept under control till the time shall come for the great battle of Armageddon. This is from SDA Bible Commentary, volume 7, 397. My dear brothers and sisters, so we have the four angels. Now let's go into our topic today. Who are holding the four winds of this earth? When the time comes, when Jesus Christ says, it's done, God will command those four angels to loosen. Then they will be, already the quotation is saying, these nations are eager. They are ready. And in the last university campus ministry, I told you guys that Putin is on pause what? Button. Yes, pause button. Who's putting him on pause button?
God.
It's God. It's God. Let's continue, my brothers. Next citation there. The vials of God's wrath will be poured out. Solemn events before us are yet to transpire. Trumpet after trumpet is to be sounded. Vial after vial poured out, one after another, upon the inhabitants of the earth. This is from Selected Messages, volume 3, 426. Let's read another one. The world is soon to be left by the angel of mercy, and the seven last plagues are to be poured out. The bolts of God's wrath are soon to fall. And when he shall begin to punish the transgressors, there will be no period of respite until the end. Testimonies to ministers and gospel workers, 182. So, what are we saying? When these vials, these plagues, start coming, there will be no period of what? Rest. It will be just one after the other. And my brothers and sisters, in early writings, the prophet said, she said, don't show me favor. These things will be bad. They'll be bad. Let us continue. The whole world will be involved in ruin. The whole world, okay? Angels are now restraining the winds of strife that they may not blow until the world shall be warned of its coming doom. But a storm is gathering, ready to burst upon the earth. And when God shall bid his angels loose the winds, there shall be such a scene of strife as no pen can picture. That is from Education 179 and 180. Another quotation, Satan will plunge the inhabitants of the earth into one great final trouble. Oh yeah. As the angels of God cease to hold in check the fierce winds of human passion, all the elements of strife, my friends, will be let loose. The whole world will be involved in ruin more terrible than that which came upon Jerusalem of old. Great Controversy 6:14. That was a very nice citation. You remember the ruin of Jerusalem of old? And you see, Jesus went in the temple. Remember the majestic entry into Jerusalem, the triumphant entry of Jesus on a donkey?
Yes.
And all the 12 tribes of Jacob had to come. It was a special day. It was, what feast was that? In that beautiful temple of Solomon. Passover. Passover. It was the Passover feast. So the Passover feast was a very celebrated feast by the children of Israel. So all 12 tribes would come to Judea, and it was something to be happy about. Passover was a triumphant. Remember? Because Passover was in Egypt. When the angel of death would pass over your house and kill the other sons of the Egyptians, the pharaohs. Now, they were celebrating, but Jesus started crying. Those who have been following the series Great Controversy, I think it was my first and second episode, I talked about Ichabod, the Ichabod, the Spirit of God has left this place. They were trapped. Remember that gentleman who went around the city of Judea warning them to flee, because destruction was coming. And Jesus said, I am crying. The disciples asked Jesus, why are you crying? When you people are celebrating, then Jesus said, in this very temple, my children will be killed because they do not listen. Just like today, people do not listen to the present what?
Truth.
There are SDAs who are not listening to the present truth. They are going to be killed, like what happened in Jerusalem in AD 70. So they came, the desolation came. We are seeing the desolation coming now. The desolation by the devil, where he's bringing economic hunger that will make people become thugs. This is the time we're supposed to be concentrating with Jesus, getting our seals so that we are passed over. So the prophet in this quotation that we read here says it will be better than that one of Jerusalem. My dear brothers, let's read another one here. Okay? All right. The whole world will be involved in what? In ruin. Okay, so God's judgment comes when God removes his protection. Yeah. So remember, I've been telling you that we are preaching the present truth to you. We are telling you to get sealed and to get serious on your knees every day. Kneel down at least how many times? And people take this to be a joke. Someone told me, no, at my workplace I can't kneel down because we are busy people. We'll see how busy you will be when you will not be sealed and the storm comes. 3 times a day, find time to worship the Creator so that he can have favor on you. You need to be connected to God, my dear brothers and sisters, more than ever. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You need to be connected to your God through prayer. And again, prayer without working, the spirit of prophecy says you will stop praying. You pray, you work. Working, what do we mean? Read the spirit of prophecy books. Read the spirit of prophecy books and also spread the news. You are not reading. People are not reading. They are listening to pastors and papas. I have quotations coming down there for you, for the papas there. Okay, let's read this one here. And I saw that the judgments of God would not come directly out from the Lord upon them, but in this way. They place themselves beyond his protection. He warns, he corrects them, he reproves, and points out the only path of safety. Then, if those who have been the objects of his special care will follow their own course, you don't want to listen, independent of the Spirit of God, you don't want God, you think you can do it alone. After repeated warnings, we have been warning you. If they choose their own way, then he does not commission his angels to protect, to prevent Satan's decided attacks upon them. That is from last day events 242. What are we talking about here? What are we talking about here, my sister, my brother? What is this citation saying? Let's not cruise. We'll crash. So this citation is saying that right now, my dear friends, we, mostly the Seventh-day Adventists, we have the Holy Spirit with us. We have the Holy Spirit. Remember the other citation we said, the angel of mercy?
Yes.
will depart the earth. When that angel of mercy leaves this earth, it means the Holy Spirit is withdrawn. It means you have been resisting. We've been preaching this message of seal. Get sealed. Get the sealing. This is how you get, because how will you be protected? And you are rejecting him. You are rejecting the Holy Spirit. He's going to be withdrawn. This is what we have just read here. When the Holy Spirit is withdrawn, then the angels of the devil have direct access to you. That will be now, you will be in darkness. You will not even be able to discern between the truth and the error. So, you will be zombies. You know what zombies are? You some SDS, you know, I receive funny things. They tell me, okay, we'll get you, we are checking you out, we're following you, but we're going to be serious when we see certain things happening. Those things are never, you will never be prepared. This is the sleeping virgins. Let us read another one. I'm not talking, making up these things. Let us read. God will use his enemies as instruments to punish those who followed their own pernicious ways. You see? God is going to allow the demons to hammer you. Pernicious ways whereby the truth of God has been misrepresented, misjudged, and dishonored. This you get from the Parson Collection of Ellen G. White, letters 136. Another one, on the same point. Already, the Spirit of God insulted, refused, and abused. You're abusing him. Is being withdrawn from the earth. Just as fast as God's Spirit is taken away, Satan's cruel work will be done upon the land and the sea. This is from manuscript 134. The same point. Another one, the wicked have passed the boundary of their protection under their probation. The Spirit of God, persistently resisted, you see, there you go, has been at last withdrawn and sheltered by divine grace. They have no protection from the wicked one. Great Controversy 6:14. My dear brothers and sisters, I am telling you, we need the Holy Spirit to protect us. The more we are presenting the present truth and telling you to dedicate yourselves wholly to the Lord, and you are mocking us, you are rejecting the warnings, the reproof, the rebukes, positive rebukes, to tell you to stop sinning. There are those papas and pastors, my brother, who tell people that don't listen to them because they are telling you things which we've not been preaching. They are telling you things of stopping to sin. You can't stop sinning. Even me as a pastor, I can't stop sinning. You know, they are culprits who stand on pulpits. Oh Lord, have mercy on these people. I'm going to read something for you. We are deep. There is something coming for them. Is it in the fourth plague? Fifth plague?
It's on the fifth plague. Yes.
For these papas and these pastors, there is something coming for you. You are telling the children of God to be at ease, to continue sinning because there is a blood which was shed on the cross. This era, anyone who continues sinning will not receive the seal of the living who?
God.
Let me read this one. Okay. All right. The battle. So now, which one was I? All right. I think I've done that one. Let us go to something else. Now, the holy angels also sometimes they practice destructive power. Hey! So, we have two colonies here. We have the righteous, the holy angels. Those, of course, who are with us here. You know that we have angels with us in this lecture theater?
Yes.
We do have angels here. Holy angels.
Yes.
Yeah, I can see the demonic angels. They are in a distant away from us. I can see them. I'm just imagining they are there. Actually, a time is coming when we are going to see these angels. These guys who are with us here, they are holy angels. A time is coming. Present truth is so nice. So, we have two battalions. We have the holy angels, we have the evil angels. A time is coming when the evil angels will do their job. They are just on pause button. God has put them, they are in check. But we're going to tell you that even the holy angels, they have got destructive what? Power. Let us read these citations. All right. The sinner must himself bear full responsibility for the punishment that is meted out to him. Ellen White states this here. Okay, this is what the prophet, the woman of God says. God destroys no one. The sinner destroys himself by his own impenitence. This is from Testimonies for the Church, my favorite book of testimonies, at page 120. You can also read The Great Controversy on the same point. God's judgments were awakened against Jericho. We are talking about the destructive powers of these holy angels. Remember the walls of Jericho?
Yes.
What happened?
The walls crumbled down.
Crumbled down! God, the children of Israel were marching around the walls of Jericho. How many times?
Seven
times. Did they have big nuclear bombs and big spears?
No.
They just had trumpets. And Jesus, the commander himself, sent his holy angels to break down those walls which were unbreakable. Oh, great. The holy angels are powerful. You can get that from Testimonies to the Church, for the Church, Volume 3, on 264. There is also a time, in one occasion, where God's angels, under God, the angels are all powerful. On one occasion, in obedience to the command of Jesus Christ, they slew of the Assyrian army in one night 185,000 men. You can get that from Desire of Ages. It will also take you to the Bible where that happened. Desire of Ages 700. Okay? There's many, many examples. I think last week I was talking about Gideon. Remember?
Yes.
Gideon had only how many soldiers?
300.
300 soldiers. To fight how many people? 122,000 Amalekites and Midianites. So that was too big. 300 versus 122,000. That was the power of the destruction. The holy angels came in and slew those people, those soldiers. They fight on our behalf. There's also another example. We have many examples. Which other example? Peter. Remember Peter?
Yeah.
Peter, there's one angel who was sent by Jesus to go and wake up Peter. Come on, Peter, get out of this cell. And the doors of the prisons went open. The same angel was sent to go and kill King Herod. And King Herod died. The spirit of prophecy says King Herod died both a mental and a physical death. You can read that from the Great Controversy 6:14. So there are many, many, many examples where the holy angels. Remember Sodom? Two angels, only two, burnt the whole Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, angels have been there to fight for us the battles. So they have that destructive power. All right. Let us go into the plagues, my dear friends. The first and the second plagues. All right. The first plague. Can we read them from the Bible? Revelation chapter what?
16.
Okay. Who's there? First plague and the second plague. Just read them at the same time. You start from verse 2 and verse 3. Yeah.
Okay. It reads, And the first went and poured out his well upon the earth, and there fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast, and upon them which worshipped his image. Verse 3, and the second angel poured out his well upon the sea, and it became as the blood of the dead man, and every living soul died in the sea.
Wow. So the first plague is noisome. I like the way they are being described. Noisome. Noisome what? Sores, eh?
Yes.
So these sores are very painful. Ah, these are so painful. And then the second plague is what? Water turning into what?
Blood.
Turns into blood. Oh, God. This is terrible. Into blood. But this water is basically in the what?
Seas.
So, this is going to be terrible. first sores on your body, if you do not want to get the seal which we've been preaching about, you have painful sores. Corona. Some of us got corona, isn't it?
Yes.
You got corona, my sister. you got corona?
Yes.
Did you enjoy it?
No, I almost died.
So, what makes people think they will enjoy these plagues? The prophet said, "Don't show me favor." These will be painful. Painful souls. Let's see what the spirit of prophecy says about these things. I'm very interested in this. Let us read here, my brothers and sisters. Okay. Okay. The first and the second plague. All right. The spirit of prophecy says, I'm quoting here, the plagues were falling upon the inhabitants of the earth. This is the first and second plague. Some were denouncing God and cursing him. So I don't think this will be good. People did not curse God during corona. People did not curse God during the coronavirus. This time you are going to curse him because it will be painful. Okay, let's continue. Others rushed. They rushed to the people of God and they begged to be taught how they might escape these judgments. You come to us, we will not be there. But the saints had nothing for them. Exactly. The last tear for the sinners had been shed, the last agonizing prayer offered, the last burden borne, the last warning given. This you get from early writings 281. You see, my dear friends, they will come running to you. You guys are being taught here to be loud cry what?
Blowers.
We are training to be blowers of the loud cry when they pass the National Sunday Law. It can be next year. Okay, but a time will come when it will be done. No more blowing the loud what? Cry. Because everyone would have heard the message and would have rejected it. The message of the present truth, the present sealing truth. People don't want to be sealed. When that happens, the souls come on them, they start looking for you now. They will remember. Don't worry, my brothers and sisters. Don't worry about people who reject the message when you are. Your job is just deliver. Deliver. Go preach to a person, tell him about the present sealing what? Truth. The Sunday law. The law of God. Leave them alone. Move on. We have 8 billion people to preach this message to. We have little time. We're not going to be begging people to get the seal of God. No. They will come begging. We've just read the quotation there. When they have painful sores on their bodies and they drink water, blood instead of water. That was from early writings of 281. The third plague here. The third plague, we read it in the Bible. It's talking about water turning into blood in the seas.
Yes.
This will annoy the people. The people are going to get annoyed. Okay, what is the spirit of prophecy saying? And I saw that the four angels would hold the four winds until Jesus' work was done in the sanctuary. And then would come the seven last plagues. These plagues enraged the wicked. You see, they got annoyed against the righteous. They thought that we had brought the judgments of God upon them. And that if they could get rid of us from this earth, the plagues would then be stayed. A decree went forth to slay the saints, which caused them to cry day and what?
Night.
Day and night for deliverance. That was from early writings 36 and 37. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, let's pause here a little bit on the second plague. Very interesting. Spirit of prophecy is saying, on the second plague, they got annoyed. First, the souls made them to curse God. Eh?
Yes.
They made them to curse God, to also run to look for us, who will not be found. Then the second plague makes them now to start, the devil gives them some brains to say, guys, it's those guys, those who are preaching present what?
Truth.
Those guys who are claiming that they are sealed, they are the ones who are bringing bad luck. Let us kill them. Second plague. Then a decree. Remember this word, we've been using it for the reformers, the Dark Ages. Decrees were made, 363 AD, remember?
Yes.
The decrees were made at the Council of what?
Laodicea.
That the people of God should be killed who are not following the Sunday law. And the papacy killed almost 100 million. This time for us, there will be a decree. So let's kill those people. They are the ones who are bringing this chaos on this earth. We are suffering because of them. It caused us to do what? To cry night and what?
Day.
We are going to cry night and death and day. Now, I'm pausing here deliberately because the second and the third plague, which we're going to tackle soon, is talking about water turning into what?
Blood.
So, the second plague, water in the sea. The third plague that we're entering into, these plagues are connected. Interconnected. Is also water in the rivers and streams, meaning all the boreholes and the taps will have blood. This is because of an angel. Let us read the Bible again. Go to, is it verse, there's an angel there who mentioned something. Read the third plague, sir, because they are intermarried. The third plague is in verse 4, yes.
Verse 4,
mm-hmm.
And the third angel poured out his veil mm-hmm. on the rivers and the fountains of waters, and they became blood.
Yes.
And I heard the angel of the water Thou art righteous, O Lord,
mm-hmm.
which art and wast and shall be,
mm-hmm.
because thou hast judged thus.
Yes. Verse 6.
For they have shed the blood of the saints and the prophets.
Exactly.
Thou hast given them blood to drink,
exactly.
For they are worthy.
Exactly. Okay. So, my dear brothers and sisters. okay. Here we have a situation where the angel is giving us a reason why God is giving these people blood to drink. Because they have shed the blood of the prophets. They have shed the blood of the saints. The prophets and the saints are the martyrs. Now this raises issues. The martyrs, all right? Now, the martyrs are the people who die for the purpose of God's service. You don't just die. When you die as a martyr, it means that God has sealed you. Mm-hmm. Please ask your questions. Let's get it slowly and understand. Today, we might even go beyond time. What's the time, sir? Okay. The martyrs are the people who have been sealed and God is saying, let them die. Now, when a martyr dies, seeds are germinated. So, martyr's death will always produce results in the kingdom of God. No martyr just dies for nothing. All right. Now, we are in the seven last plagues. Are we saying we are going to have martyrs in the seven last plagues? Because remember, the first plague comes after the servants of God are what? Sealed in their foreheads. All the 144,000 will be sealed. Okay? Then God commands his angels to loosen, the four angels, to loosen the winds of the earth. And then comes now the seven last plagues. So are we saying these martyrs, who this angel is talking about, are in the 144,000? No, my friends, no. The spirit of prophecy, I think I'll give you a verse, a citation, says there will be no martyrs when the four angels are loosened. There will be no martyrs when the four angels are loosened. No martyrs. Okay? Then, which martyrs is he talking about? Alright, so I'm going to explain it in two phases. The first part, just by the The mere pronunciation or pronouncement that a decree should be passed to kill the saints of the living God, already they have sinned. So there will be no martyrs in the 144,000. After the four angels are loosened, there will be no martyrs. But the angel is responding to what we just read in our spirit of prophecy, where they will say, let us now kill them in the second plague. Let us kill them because they are the ones who are causing this. Just by saying, let us kill them, and making a decree to say, kill those guys. Already they have killed us. Already they have killed us. Hey, how does that happen? You know, you sin before you implement. You sin in your brain. In fact, this is an implementation, because even a decree has been given out to kill. So they sin before they actually kill. But during the seven last plagues, we will not have any martyrs. Because martyrs are for a purpose of winning souls to the kingdom of God. So in the seven last plagues, there will be no souls which will be won. The number would have been done. Christ would have closed the books, and it would be already 144,000 sealed saints scattered all over the world. So there will be no reason for a human being to be killed as a martyr of God. Then when are we going to have the martyrs? When are we going to have the martyrs? Yes, brother Andrew.
During the loud cry.
Correct! During the loud cry. If next year they pass the National Sunday Law, the loud cry begins. Some of us will be martyrs. For example, if I'm a martyr, I'm whatever formula they will use to kill me, I don't know. I'm not going to choose for them. Maybe they'll chop off my head like John the Baptist. Maybe they'll cut me into half like Isaiah. I don't know. Maybe they'll crucify me like Peter. Or maybe they'll stone me like Stephen. Whatever, if I'm martyred, after we start blowing the loud cry next year, for example, if it starts next year, it means I'm going to win many souls into the kingdom of God. It's possible we are actually going to have martyrs during the loud cry session. But martyrs end when the four angels are what? Loosened. It means the sealing is done. There is a number called 144 at 1,000. We're going to study more on that number because there's a lot that is involved in that number. But let me give you some citations over what we have just learned about here. Okay. When you go to a book called Our High Calling, 357, the Spirit of Prophecy says, if we are called to suffer for Christ's sake, we shall be able to go to prison, trusting in him as a little child trusts in his parents. Now is the time to cultivate the faith in God. That's a serious one. So, meaning we're going to go to what? Prisons.
Yes.
Some of us will be put in prisons. Okay. The prison, the Spirit of Prophecy says the prisons will be like palaces. We'll be in prison, but it will be a palace because you will be a child of God. You'll be shining. That was a nice quotation. Another one here. Many will be put to death. The best thing for us is to come into close connection with God. And if he would have us to be martyrs for the truth's sake, it may be the means of bringing many more into the truth. That was from Selected Messages, Volume 3, 420. That is a very nice citation, my dear brothers and sisters. So we'll have martyrs in that era, just like the Spirit of Prophecy here is actually saying it will be. Okay, I'll give you a last one still. Okay, on martyrs, because we need to know that we either can be martyrs or we can be part of the 144,000. So, and again, Spirit of Prophecy says, do not have issues with who is going to belong in the 144,000. Let's not have issues. Hey, you will be in the 144,000. Hey, you will be a martyr. It's up to God. So some of us will be martyrs, and some of us will be in the 144,000 group. So whatever comes, you'll be ready for it, because God will make you ready for it. Okay, another one, maybe just the last one for you in that martyr arrangement. Many will be imprisoned. Many will flee for their lives from cities and towns. And many will be martyrs for Christ's sake in standing in defense of the truth. That is from Selected Messages, Volume 3, page 397. All right, my friends, let us continue with the plagues. We were on the third plague. We are on the third plague, so let us continue with the plagues. I'm going to read a citation. Remember, the third plague is the waters turning into blood in the rivers and streams, meaning those boreholes which you have in your backyard, you'll be drinking blood because you don't want to get sealed. You'll hate the seal. For hating the seal, you're going to drink blood. All right. The third plague here, let me quote here for you, from the book Great Controversy. And the rivers and fountains of water became blood. Terrible as these inflictions are, God's justice, God's justice fully vindicated. The angel of God declares, "Thou art righteous, O Lord, because thou hast judged thus, for they have shed the blood of the saints and the prophets, and thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy." That was what we just read in Revelation 16, verse 2 to 6. By condemning the people of God to death, they have as truly incurred the guilt of their blood, as if it had been shed by their own hands. Great Controversy. In fact, we talked of this, huh?
Yes.
We explained it, sir. We said, just because they passed a decree to say, let's kill these guys because of the first and the second plague, just that was enough to be murderers. But also, I've given you citations which say that during the loud cry, there will be martyrs. Some of us will be martyrs during the loud cry. You want to be a martyr, my brother?
Yes.
You want to be a martyr, my sister? Okay. The some of you do not know what you want to be. But anyway, the Spirit of Prophecy says, the question of who's going to compose the 144,000 should not be our problem, because that is God's what? Decision. So whatever comes your way, you should pick it up. Let me also emphasize, okay, let me give you this citation here, still on the third plague, my friends. If the blood of Christ's faithful witnesses were shed at this time, it would not, like the blood of martyrs, be as seed sown to yield a harvest for God. Oh, we just explained that, my brother, remember?
Yes.
Yeah, so any martyrs that will come after the four angels are loosened, those martyrs will not be for God. They will be for the devil. Maybe he will do that to just deceive you. We will not have martyrs after the four angels are loosened. After the first plague starts being poured out, will not have any martyrs, because they will not win a seed. They will not sow a seed. There is nothing that... A martyr's death should always win souls for the kingdom of God. Let's go to the fourth plague, my dear brothers and sisters. What is the fourth plague? Can we read it? Who can read for us? You need to be studious, pious, and intelligent. Go to verse 8. Yes.
Verse 8, and it reads, And the fourth angel poured out his veil upon the sun, and power was given unto him to scorch men with fire.
Mm.
And men were scorched with great heat, and blasphemed the name of God, which had power over these plagues.
Mm.
And they repented not to give him glory.
Oh, praise God. The fourth plague is what?
The sun scorching.
Okay, the sun. You know, here in Zambia we have a very, very tough season called the what? Summer? It comes in October.
Yes.
It's bad, right? Yeah. Now, can you imagine how bad it is? How it's going to be? It's going to be bad. The sun. No, you can imagine dodging it. Air cons will be melted. The fans, whatever formulas you try. And the prophet says, the spirit of prophecy says, we'll see dead bodies. The sun is going to be bad. It's going to kill. Dead bodies will be all over. Let me just read what, you see, there were certain prophets. That's why I love the spirit of prophecy. That's why we should love Ellen White. There are certain prophets in the Old Testament who wrote about this. You know, this is God's word. Huh? This is Jesus. The same Jesus who's coming. Where the vials are coming from. So he gave the word of the future to certain men who he anointed and chose. Let's go to some prophets. You know, Hosea, Joel, and the like. Let me give you some of those readings. Okay, Joel 1 verse 10 to 12. Talked about it. And also from Joel 1 verse 10 to 12, verse 17 to 20, and also prophet Amos. Those are prophets, people don't even know that they are serious. Amos 8 verse 3. These prophets prophesied of this. They say, the land mourneth because the harvest of the field is perished. All the trees of the field are withered because joy is withered away from the sons of men. The seed is rotten under their clothes. Their garners are laid desolate. How do the beasts' grain groan? The heads of the cattle are perplexed because they have no pasture. The rivers of water are dried up, and the fire hath devoured the pastures of the wilderness. The songs of the temple shall be howlings in that day, saith the Lord God. There shall be many dead bodies in every place. They shall cast them forth with the silence. So you can get this also from last day events, 245.3. Okay, from great controversy, these plagues are not universal. We're talking about we're still on the fourth plague. They are not universal, or the inhabitants of the earth would be wholly cut off. Yet they will be the most awful scourges that have ever been known to mortals. Great controversy 6:28 and 6:29. So, what else have we learned there? These plagues will not be global, yes. So, we'll be hearing these things. You just hear, in Zambia, there are countries which are in danger. Zambia is one of them. America, which other one? South Africa,
Russia.
Guys, we're going to feel it. So if I was in one of these countries, I'll be serious with the seal. I'll be serious with the present sealing truth. So I'm sealed and protected from what is coming. Zambia. Oh, I cry, Mother Zambia. Zambia, Zambia, Zambia. So it will not be universal. Spirit of prophecy says, but they will be bad. And each country will be given a share of these seven last what? Plagues. Let's go to the fifth plague. Can we read the Bible? That is verse 10. Read the Bible. Yes, sir.
Verse 10, mm-hmm. It reads, and the fifth angel poured out his veil upon the seat of the beast, mm-hmm. And his kingdom was full of darkness, and they gound their tongues for pain and blasphemed the God of heaven because their pain and their souls and repented not of their deeds.
Mm. So, the fifth plague is what? Darkness, yes. Right? This is now where the things get sensitive and more interesting. You know, these plagues, the more we go down, the more bad this world is. Why am I saying so? It is in the fifth plague that the people are forced to look into the sky. Remember, it's darkness. It's in the fifth plague where now they say, let's kill these guys. You see, each plague, remember the second plague, they said, let's kill them. They even issued a decree.
Yes.
And then now we're in the fifth plague. They are suffering. They're like, why are we? Let's kill this group. Again, it comes in the fifth plague. Let's kill this group. Then God gives them darkness. Then all of a sudden, we'll be in different camps. Okay? In the bush. As sealed saints, 144, different companies, that is what spiritual prophecy calls them, lead to companies. And as they come to kill, they see now rainbow. First, they see a big rainbow in the sky. After that, rainbows on each little company in the bush of the sealed saints. Then now they will realize their stupid and dull and foolish brains will open up to say, hey, this is God protecting these fellas. Oh, they will feel ashamed. And they will try by all means to hide from the brightness of God. Let me just read this quickly for you so that you get it from the written word. With a shout of triumph, jeering, and imprecation, throngs of evil men are about to rush upon their prey when, lo, a dense darkness, deeper than the darkness of the night, falls upon the earth. Then a rainbow, shining with the glory from the throne of God, spans the heavens and seems to encircle each praying company. I love that. The angry multitudes are suddenly arrested. Their mocking cries die away. The objects of their murderous rage are forgotten. With fearful forebodings, they gaze upon the symbol of God's covenant and long to be shielded from his overpowering brightness. That is from Last Day Events 246.2. There appears against the sky a hand holding two tables of stone. Now look at the drama. In the sky they see two tables of stone folded together, says the prophet. The heavens shall declare his righteousness, for God is judge himself. In Psalm 50 verse 6, the holy law, God's righteousness, that amid thunder and flame was proclaimed from Sinai at the guide of life, as the guide of life, is now revealed to men as the rule of judgment. The hand opens the tables, and there are seen the precepts. We know the precepts are the commandments of the Decalogue, traced as with a pen of fire. The words are so plain that all can read them. Memory is aroused. The darkness of suspicion and heresy is swept from every mind. Oh God. And God's 10 words, brief, comprehensive, and authoritative, are presented to the view of all the inhabitants of the earth. Great controversy, my dear friends. This is 6:39. So you see the drama? So in the thickness of the darkness, they see a hand in the sky. All of you who don't want to see, you are going to see this. You see the hand in the sky with two tables of what? Stone, golden-like. And then a hand opens them. And when the hand opens them, you see the inscription of the 10 commandments. My dear friends, even without the seal that some of us will be having, You'll be given, is it binocular size?
Yes.
Those eyes which can see on a distance. The spirit of prophecy says you will see the commandments so clearly and simple. Even if you never went to school, you'll be able this time to read English, which will be written. You will know that is thou shalt not commit adultery. You will see the one that is shining most of the Sabbath. Oh my God. And then your brains will wake up now. Your brains will wake up. Now let's continue here. Church members who have seen the light and been convicted, but who have trusted the salvation of their souls to the minister. This thing of trusting pastors. This is now where I was saying pastors are in trouble. Remember when we started?
Yes.
Pastors are in trouble here. Fellas like Ted Wilson, fellas like John Lamacain, thank you, my sister there. John Lamacain, who is this other one? These guys are preaching prophecy. We fellas, and SDA, Ted Wilson, John Lamacain, Mark Finley, yeah? Dog, whatever. My brothers and sisters, all these fellas. Look at this one, Ted Wilson. Can you see what is behind him there? Why is he having the moon? And you see, these videos, he's presenting them every day, Ted Wilson. He has a moon behind there. Just last week I was talking about him. He was in Ramadan, supporting Ramadan. And he's been shooting. When you go to his page, you'll see this moon which is behind him there. You will see the upside down cross. You know, you are seeing things. You don't see the three angels' messages there. These are the people who we are talking about. Let me read here. I'm not making up these stories. I'm reading Spirit of Prophecy. Church members who have seen the light and have been convicted, but who have trusted the salvation of their souls to the minister. No, they can't be wrong, those ones. We will learn in the day of God that no other soul can pay for the ransom for their transgression. A terrible cry will be raised. I am lost, eternally lost. Men will feel as though they could rend in pieces the minister who have preached falsehoods and condemned the truth of present truth. SDA Bible Commentary, Volume 4, 1157. So, in the fifth plague, you people who are refusing the present truth, the present sealing truth, you are going to go to the Dr. Ted Wilson's, Johnny Mamaken, and all these, why do I always miss this name? John, whatever. And all these characters who are preaching prophecy, but they're not telling you to get sealed. You are going to feel like breaking them into pieces. But you know, it will be too late for you as well. Let me read another one here. All will unite in heaping their bitterest condemnation upon the ministers. Can you see again? And faithful pastors. Oh, Sister White has used the word pastors. Finally, we've been looking for pastors. People are saying, why are you saying sleeping pastors? But it's the same arrangement. So she says, and faithful what? Pastors have prophesied smooth what? Things. You know, you are in church. Someone is preaching romantic stories. Sabbath, main service, remnant church. They never tell you to get sealed. And you are flying up and down skates and Dockers uniforms, flying, saying amen. I don't understand. Lord, have mercy. Let's pray for this people. Mighty Father, Lord, have mercy on your children, Mighty Father. Have mercy on them. Give them a little time, Lord. Hold on. Hold on. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. You know, my dear brothers and sisters, let me read. All of you are going to unite. I'm reading Spirit of Prophecy, this great controversy. Unite in heaping their bitterest condemnation upon the ministers and faithful pastors have prophesied smooth things which make you scream amen. They have led their hearers to make void the law of God. I'm telling you to stop sinning and to persecute those who would keep it holy. They are telling you to hate us and persecute us. Now, in their despair, these teachers confess, Ted Wilson will confess if he doesn't change, before the world, their wake of deception, the multitudes are filled with fury. I'm telling you, they're going to stone these guys. We are lost, they cry, and you are the cause of our ruin. And they turn upon these false shepherds, you see? Yeah, they are going to beat them. The very ones that once admired the most, yeah, as we are dead, those on diehards, will pronounce the most dreadful curses upon them. The very hands that once crowned them, yeah, our king is dead, also, our king is Pastor Tembo, crowned them with laurels, will now be raised for their destruction. They're gonna stone you, Mr. Pastor. The swords which were to slay God's people, now you are crucifying us, are now employed to destroy their enemies. Great controversy, 655, 656. My dear friends, you are in trouble. Now, let me warn you, the pastor. You, the pastors, who are inciting, you know, the way this system works, eh? The devil sends demoniacs in our churches. Eh? Those demoniacs, some of them with big positions in government and NGOs, whatever companies, they come there, they spread those demons to these pastors. Stupid pastor also, you just follow instructions. You hate us. You hate the present sealing truth. I'm warning you, pastors. Plague number 5. Those weapons, you are going to be cut into pieces by these same church members who you are deceiving. You are telling them not to listen to the present sealing truth. You are telling them don't get sealed. Don't listen. There are three groups. There's these pastors and the Davidians. These Davidians. The Davidians are the culprits because these ones are following a lost prophet called Victor Hotef, who hated Ellen White. There is only one truth, one spirit of prophecy. But again, let me come. There are those people, demoniacs, who are in the system, who have given themselves power to beat up Davidians, clear Davidians, insult Davidians. Who told you to do that? Do us in present truth beat? Were we sent by Jesus to beat Davidians up?
No.
There are people in these churches. I'm going to shoot Davidians. I'm going to slap them. I'm going to beat them. Who sent you to do that? We pray for Davidians. They are lost. Just like you, you're also lost. A lost one is beating another lost one. So we have these groups in the church. Davidians, I know some of them. Mr. Sam, I'm now mentioning your names. You are the Davidians. Mr. Sam, we have interacted. Stop misleading people. Stop misleading people. Sleeping pastors also, stop misleading people. In plague number 5, you're going to feel it. Okay, let's continue, my dear friends, to plague number 6. We don't have enough time here. Can we go to the Bible? Revelation chapter what? 16 verse, go to verse 6. Read it for us, sir.
It reads verse 4. Mm-hmm. And the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river, mm-hmm. Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, mm-hmm. and the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. Mm. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs, mm-hmm. come out of the mouth of the dragon, mm-hmm. and out of the mouth of the beast, mm-hmm. and out of the mouth of the false prophets. Mm-hmm. For they are spirits of devils, working miracles, which go forth unto the kings of the earth, mm-hmm. and of the whole world, to gather them to the battle of the great day of God Almighty. Mm-hmm.
Continue.
Behold, I come as a thief.
We are now, take note, we have now entered the battle of the Armageddon. Continue.
Behold, I come as a thief. Mm-hmm. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame.
Good. End it there. Now, the sixth plague, between the sixth, the battle of Armageddon comes in the sixth plague. Okay? These are unclean what?
Spirits.
Unclean spirits. Looking like frog legs, huh?
Yes.
Very, very bad. And these spirits go to who?
The kings of the earth.
Okay. So, they go to the kings of the earth now to prepare. Remember, every plague makes them more furious and more annoyed and more hate to kill the saints of the living God, the 144 who are in different companies. So, this time now, the evil spirit comes up and says, we've tried and tried. This time, let's finish this game. Let's finish these guys. Let's go and kill them. We are now in the battle of Armageddon. So now, the kings of the earth, the presidents, Putin, this one and this one, now they gather up the armies. Remember, we said God gives permission to evil angels too. The same power that our holy angels have, of destruction, is the same power the evil angels have also. They were together in heaven. It's just that they are on pause button. They are in check with those four angels. God is checking. He's telling them, you can't do that. Who are you? You are fallen angels. But this time, he's going to let them loose. He said, okay, let's see your power. Since you say you have power, let's see your power and let's see how far your power can go. That is the battle of Armageddon. The forces of darkness will be given all the powers. Next week, I'll be preaching about Jacob's trouble. That will be a nice one also. We are going to cry. The 144 will cry because they will feel that this time we are being killed, but they will hold on Jacob's trouble. Let me just give you some quotations on the Battle of Armageddon here. The great opposing powers are revealed in the last great battle. On one side stands the creator of heaven and earth, and on the other side, his subject. They are obedient to his commands. On the other side stands the prince of darkness with those who have chosen apostasy and rebellion. This is SDA Bible Commentary, Volume 7, 982. So we only have how many sides?
Two.
Okay, who are involved in the Battle of Armageddon? Yes, sir.
Satan and his angels.
Mm-hmm.
God and his angels.
Mm-hmm.
The 144,000.
So we have.
And the people who are deceived.
Good. We have four groups.
Yes.
We have, in terms of human beings, we only have two groups. Two groups. You either on the left or on the right. And the funny part is that the group on the right is the small group, 144,000. And all the people will be on the left. Then they'll be with the evil angels. And then on the right we'll have the what? The righteous angels. Let me give you another quotation. A terrible conflict is before us. We are nearing the battle of the great day of the God of God Almighty. That which has been held in control is to be let loose. The angel of mercy, like we said before, is folding her wings, preparing to step down from the throne and to leave the world to the control of Satan. The principalities and the powers of the earth are in a bitter revolt against the God of heaven. They are filled with hatred against those who save him, and soon will be fought in the last great battle between good and evil. The earth is to be the battlefield, the scene of the final contest and the final victory. Here, where for so long Satan has led men against God, rebellion is to be forever suppressed. That is from Review and Herald on May 13, 1902. Okay? The battles waging between the two armies are as real as those fought in the armies of this world. And on the issue of the spiritual conflict, eternal destinies will depend on this. That's from Prophets and Kings 176. All the world will be on one side or the other of the question. The Battle of Armageddon will be fought, and that day must find none of us sleeping. Wide awake we must be as wise virgins, having oil in our vessels with our lamps. The power of the Holy Ghost must be upon us, and the captain of the Lord's host will stand at the head of the angels of heaven to direct the battle. That is from Selected Messages, Volume 3, 426. The enmity of Satan against good will be manifested more and more as he brings his forces into activity in his last work of rebellion. And every soul that has not fully surrendered to God and kept by divine power will form an alliance with Satan. You see, you're going to join this side against the heaven and join in the battle against the ruler of the universe. Testimonies of ministers to ministers and gospel workers 465. So I'm giving you citations on the Battle of Armageddon. Soon all the judgments of the earth will have taken sides. All the inhabitants of the earth, would have taken sides. Whether you like it, you will take a side, my friend. Either for or against the government of heaven. Testimonies for the Church, Volume 7, 141. Okay, my dear friends, those are citations on the Battle of Armageddon. We continue. The powers of evil will not yield up the conflict without a struggle, but Providence has a part to act in the Battle of Armageddon. When the earth is lighted with the glory of the angel of Revelation 18. We know the angel of Revelation 18?
Yes.
Which angel is this one?
Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit? Which angel is this one? Come on, you're loud cry blowers. Yes, sir?
The angel which gives power for the children of God to give the loud cry.
Exactly, good. So, it is the angel that gives power. The fourth angel, right?
Yes.
We preach about our message is to blow the third angel's what? Message. But we'll be assisted with the fourth angel. That is, Revelation 14 basically is the blowing of the loud cry. The loud cry message, the message of the loud cry will be, come out of her, my people, right?
Yes.
Come out of Babylon, right? And we know what Babylon is.
Yes.
I think in the last university campus ministry, I explained that Babylon is the mother of what? And she has what?
Daughters.
So the daughters are the all these churches which are going to unite with Catholic. Those are the daughters of Babylon. All right, let me just give you one more citation here, then we'll call it a day. Okay? The battle of Armageddon is soon to be fought. He in on whose vesture is written in the name King of Kings and Lord of Lords leads forth the armies of heaven on white horses, clothed in fine linen, clean and white. So you can get that from SDA Bible Commentary, Volume 7, 982. And the last citation of the day, the whole earth heaves and swells like the waves of the sea. Its surface is breaking up. That's now the battle. Its very foundations seem to be giving way. Mountain chains are sinking. Inhabited islands disappear. The seaports that have become like Sodom for wickedness are swallowed up by the angry waters. The proudest cities of the earth are laid low. The lordly palaces, these palaces upon which the world's great men have lavished their wealth, you know, Putin has all that palace and so on, so in order to glorify themselves, are crumbling to ruin before their eyes. Prison walls are rent asunder, and God's people who have been held in bondage for their faith, those in prisons, are set free. So, Great Controversy 637. Today, we have talked about the seven last plagues, the battle of Armageddon. The battle of Armageddon is different from the Third World War. The battle of Armageddon is the last battle this earth will encounter. It's the last battle. We are going to see if those nuclear bombs are going to win the battle. But according to Spirit of Prophecy, and the Spirit of Prophecy, which is the word of Jesus, we are going to win the battle. They are going to lose.
Amen.
Us, we are going to win the battle. And they are going to lose. Jesus is winning this time, my dear brothers and sisters. Jesus is winning. And we also learned today that martyrs will be there. Some of us will be martyrs. Some of us will be in part of the 144,000. And it's not our issue to worry who is going to be where and where. And we know that the battle of Armageddon will be led by our commander, Jesus Christ, and his host of angels on pure white, clean garments. You know, I like the word clean. Because we will be there watching this battle. You also, if you are joining the team which wants to be sealed and to be on the positive side, you'll be watching the battle. And we'll see the devil and the Satanists and all these people who have rejected the present truth on the other side. We're going to win this battle. And I don't think it's a good experiment to see if you're going to win this battle. If you'll be on the devil's side, you're going to lose. Because the 6,000 years of this book has come to an end. And the end of this book is victory in the battle of Armageddon. My dear brothers and sisters, let us end it here today. Let us pray to God so much so that we can be on the side of the great commander who is dressed in what? In white. In the battle of Armageddon. That is the last battle that will end this world. In fact, the seventh last plague is the end of the story. Remember, the seventh plague says there are stones which will come and will be like bullets.
Yes.
Those will be bullets to destroy the soldiers on the other side in this battle of Armageddon. Those bullets are not coming to play. They are stones which are coming from our soldiers who are dressed in white. It is the last battle this earth will ever see. You need to get the seal. You need to get the seal, my brother. My sister, you need to get the seal of the living God. Let us pray, my friends. Mighty Father who dwells in heaven, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for giving us this lesson, Lord. Lord, we pray, Lord, that you help us the battles that are coming are too bad and painful, but only those whom you will see will survive. We pray, Lord, that we join the little company, the little flock according to spirit of prophecy and the Bible. Put us there, mighty Father. We bow at your holy throne. We worship you because there's no other God to be worshipped. We can't worship the moon, the sun, and anything else, Lord. We worship you. Forgive us our sins. Show us the way. Give us the wisdom, mighty Father. We humble ourselves at your holy feet. Those who are still dragging, Lord, those who are still in the valley of the five foolish virgins, we pray, Lord, that they can trim up their lamps, fill them up with your Holy Spirit, remove the obstacles of demonic forces in our pastors, in our members, in our church, and everyone, Lord. Help your children, mighty Father, we pray. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, my friends, let us meet next week. Again, we carry it on from here. Next week, we'll have another interesting inspiration from the spirit of prophecy. May God bless you.